Greetings. I just finished watching a video of Dr. Nabil Qureshi, From Islam to Freedom in Christ. It blessed me and encouraged me, and I recommend you watch it. One thought I came away with is this. This is not about me or you or our individual desires and comforts. We will experience hardship as we follow God. Acts 14:21, and having proclaimed the gospel to that city and having discipled many, they returned to Lystra and to Iconium and to Antioch. Acts 14:22, strengthening the souls of the disciples and encouraging them to continue in the faith. We must endure many hardships to enter the kingdom of God, they said. We will experience tribulation and difficulty as we follow God. John 16:33, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. This is not speaking about the 7-year tribulation of Daniel's 70th week. This is about the general persecution Christians will face in this world. John 15:18, if the world hates you, understand that it hated me first. The world will not love us when we follow Christ. John 15:19, if you were of the world, it would love you as its own. Instead, the world hates you because you are not of the world. But I have chosen you out of the world. We really need to grasp that during the last days. James 4:4, you adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility toward God? Therefore, whoever chooses to be a friend of the world renders himself an enemy of God. We really need to grasp this during the last days. As the world that hates God and curses God, even while claiming God, does not exist, it will persecute Christians while it submits to Islam. But what does being friends with the world really mean? Romans 8:7, because the mind of the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. This is part of it, being carnally minded. It is partly the mentality we adopt from the world. Every human is subject to and tempted by selfish human thoughts, even the disciples. Matthew 16:21, from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. No doubt this was troubling to his disciples, to the point Peter could not contain himself. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Far be it from you, Lord, he said. This shall never happen to you. And having turned, he, Jesus, said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for your thoughts are not of the things of God, but the things of men. Peter was not personally Satan, but the thoughts Peter was allowing to ramble around in his mind were not from God. And having turned, he said to Peter, get behind me, Satan, for your thoughts are not of the things of God, but the things of men. This is why we are taught to take control of our thinking. 2 Corinthians 10:4, the weapons of our warfare are not the weapons of the world. Instead, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We are destroying speculations and every lofty thing raised up against the knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. An interesting phrase, taking every thought captive. The King James Version, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Bringing into captivity every thought. Captives are taken during battle. So make no mistake, you are in a spiritual war. For the weapons of our warfare, you equip yourself for the trials and tribulations and attacks by facing your selfishness as a part of it, because this is not about you. Ask not what the kingdom of heaven can do for you, but what can you do to serve and advance the kingdom of heaven, to serve God who sacrificed himself for you. Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. Don't let those be hollow words that flow in one ear and pass out the other. Think what it means that Christ lives in you. Yeshua, the Messiah, promised to live in you. John 14:18, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. In a little while, the world will see me no more, but you will see me, because I live, you also will live. At that day you shall know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. He that has my commandments and keeps them, he it is that loves me. And he that loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. Jesus replied, If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. It's not about you. It's about the one in you. How then can we walk in this new life God has given us? Romans 8:9. You, however, are controlled not by the flesh, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. Ephesians 3:16, I pray that out of the riches of his glory, he may strengthen you with power through his Holy Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. God wants to fill you up with himself. Now, given that, consider what Paul also wrote. Romans 8:35, Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? Can a sword separate your spirit from the Spirit of God dwelling in you? Keep that in mind when Islam comes for your head with a sword. Do not fear death, and do not reject the Son of God. Revelations 12:11. They have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives so as to shy away from death. 1 Corinthians 15:54, When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come to pass, Death has been swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? It's not about you. Don't let Satan guilt you with woulda, shoulda, coulda. Philippians 3:13, Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have laid hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize of God's heavenly calling in Christ Jesus. It's not about us. It's about him. John 3:16, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge or condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Romans 10:9, That if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you call yourself Muslim, this means you must believe Jesus is God come in the flesh, as the prophets foretold. If you desire to know where did the prophets foretell God come in the flesh, just ask, and I'll be honored and humbled to explain it to you, brother. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.